How do things work in the cloud? What's on my plate versus my cloud service provider? Why isn't there a simple way of telling who does what? How do we share all of these responsibilities? Good news, there is a simple-ish way of figuring all this out. It's called the shared responsibility model, and whether you know it or not, you've been using it for years. This model is rock solid. It's not cloud specific, and it even applies to on-premises environments. The underlying idea is this. There are six broad categories where work needs to be done consistently. Someone is responsible for doing that work. That's it. That's the entire premise of the model. On-premises, you don't think about this way of working too often because all those people doing the work, well, they typically fall under the same organizational structure. That's frequently the CIO's team. But even here, we start to see the first glimpses of sharing responsibilities with external parties. Businesses frequently have contracts with internet service providers for various connections to the outside world. Sometimes you rent space in a data center, also known as co-location. Or you have a company take care of the physical aspects of a data center that you own. Somewhere in the stack of work to be done, someone outside of your team is on the hook for that work. You might even say, sharing the responsibility for it. Now, when we look towards the cloud, this model can get confusing quickly. And that's in no small part due to how the big three CSPs present it. With AWS, the model is often presented as a lot of boxes in layers stacked together. Azure prefers more of a linear graph model. And Google? Well, Google just dropped it all in an 80-page document. Now, if you've seen any of my other videos, you know that I like to keep things simple. Now, this is a mental model that's designed to help you understand the broad strokes of how you and your cloud service provider work together to run your solutions. Simple is better. That's why I like to present the model in six straightforward categories: physical, infrastructure, virtual, operating system, application, and data. Now, depending on the type of cloud service that you're building with, you're responsible for 1, 2, 3 of these areas. Regardless of the service, you're always responsible for your data and the configuration of the service you're using. That's it. Let's dive a little deeper into each of these categories and then come back to the high level to understand how to apply this model to its best effect. The physical layer is the most straightforward to understand. From the real estate that makes up the data center to the physical servers running the services, this is the part you can touch. Well, someone can touch. There's a lot of work to be done at this level. Some of it, like real estate negotiations, well, they only happen once every few years. Other things, like replacing burnt out hard drives, happen far more frequently. At the end of the day, it's all work that needs to be done and kept on top of. Builders rarely even think about this layer, and honestly, that's a good thing, as long as someone else is taking care of it. Infrastructure is everything required to connect, power, heat, and cool all of these computing systems. If you've never worked at the data center layer, you might not realize the complexities involved here. Trust me when I say there are a lot. The simpler areas are heating and cooling, making sure that there's enough capacity to cool the data center, dealing with all that waste heat, adding redundancies. These are challenging real-world problems that often run up against the laws of physics. Now, like the physical layer, we don't talk enough about this aspect of building. That's part of the power of the cloud for builders, but I think it's important to understand that this is still a requirement, and a lot of careful engineering and planning are required to make sure that we are building on a strong foundation. Now, the virtual layer is the first layer of major abstraction. This is where the cloud service provider takes all of these separate physical things like servers and storage and networking and pools them together in order to deliver what we know as the cloud. When you take a step back, it can be a little odd to think that the virtual machine or instance that you asked for in the cloud is actually just a fragment of a physical computer somewhere. Now, that fragment is only possible because all of the computers, which are running their own operating systems and need to be maintained just like your instance, have been stitched together using a virtualization system. Each cloud provider has added their own applications and systems at this layer to actually build out their cloud. That's a little hint as to where the first major division of responsibilities falls under this model. We're all familiar with operating systems, whether that's Windows, macOS, Linux, or one of the mobile OSs. This low-level software is responsible for providing an interface to the hardware and other resources connected to the system. The OS is the core piece running our solutions. Now, this layer is the first one where it's possible that you, the builder, will have responsibilities. If you've asked for a virtual machine or an instance from your CSP, you're going to get the keys to the castle, so to speak. When provisioned, you'll be provided with the administrator or root access and the ability to do almost anything to that operating system. After all, it's your responsibility. So if you want to set the password to password and remove all of the safeguards in the OS, you can. Please don't. But you could, if you wanted to. Again, please don't. There's a surprising amount of work to be done at the OS level that you really want to avoid wherever possible. Patching, tuning, configuring, and other activities are required on a regular basis. This work usually doesn't move your solution forward. It's undifferentiated heavy lifting. The application layer sits on top of the operating system and can range from something basic to significantly complex. Just like with the operating system level, you want to delegate this to your cloud service provider whenever possible. However, there are occasions when you want to take on the work of performance tuning, regular maintenance, and configuration. Most CSP service offerings are tuned to a general purpose. Specific needs and use cases are often why builders will use services that give you the application layer responsibility. Regardless of the service you use in the cloud, you are always responsible for your data or the data entrusted to you by your customers. You need to understand the service you're evaluating and whether or not it processes and stores data in a way that matches your appetite for risk. The big three CSPs all have a very strong identity and access management fabric woven into everything that they do. And this fabric is critical to making sure that your data is handled the way that you want. The configuration of that identity and access management system falls under service configuration and is firmly your responsibility. The six layers of this model, physical, infrastructure, virtual, operating systems, application, and data, lay out who does what work. This line between you and the CSP changes for each and every service that you use. You have to understand where that line is for each piece of your solution. Otherwise, you're opening yourself and your organization up to risks that you might not be aware of. There are two key things to remember about this model. The first, you are never responsible for the physical, infrastructure, or virtualization layers in the cloud. Some of the choices that you make will impact those areas, like what region to work in, but these areas are always the CSP's responsibility. The second key point is that you are always responsible for your data and the configuration of the services that you use in the cloud. The shared responsibility model does more than just dictate how operations and security works in the cloud. It's also a guide on how to maximize the value you're getting from building in the cloud. Where possible, you should be choosing services that are towards the right side of this model. A lot of the time, these services are tagged with words like SaaS, managed, or even serverless. Now, why would you choose these type of services? Because the cloud service provider is doing more of the work. Getting the CSPs to do more of that undifferentiated work on your behalf is always a win. It allows you to focus your time and effort on delivering direct business value. Yes, the direct service cost could be more expensive. Running a managed database server might cost you $1 per hour compared to 50 cents per hour if you ran it yourself. But think of all the work that you're taking on. If you run the database yourself, you have to worry about balancing the workload, updating the system, protecting that system against various threats, backing it up regularly, and more. While the 50% cost savings is attractive in the beginning, once you start to factor in the total cost, like the time spent maintaining the system and the cost of not having time to build new features, you'll quickly realize that the default choice should be towards the right side of the shared responsibility model. The shared responsibility model is simple in its premise. You and the cloud service provider share responsibility for daily work across six key areas. The model has two key constraints. You, the builder, are never responsible for the physical, infrastructure, or virtual layers. You, as a builder, are always responsible for your data and the configuration of the services that you use in the cloud. That just leaves you to determine whether the service you're using makes you responsible for the operating system and the application layers. Despite some of the ways of presenting this model, it's actually that simple.